For this one, we're really focusing on just introduction to CSS and HTML as a whole. And the takeaway from this is kind of best practices with CSS and HTML, as well as methodologies for creating scalable projects. And the takeaway that I really want you guys to have is a firm understanding of best practices of CSS, some methodologies, as well as how to position things on the page. So we're going to be talking things about like the media object and the flag object, which are the basis of object-oriented CSS, which I can explain all these things. And with this whole, over the next 3 weeks, I want you guys to be really, really involved, be disruptive. Like, that's what this is for, and that's why we have smaller classes, because if we didn't want them to be in this format, we would have invited a lot more people, but we wanted to keep it like 10 people, and we figured 10 was the right amount. And hopefully over the next 3 weeks, you guys all get to know each other too. And I don't know if you guys are interested. We kind of talk about this afterwards. If you're going to create like a Slack group where you can talk, but I've said this, I've reached out to all of you like throughout this, do not hesitate to ask questions, whether it's today, whether you think of something next week or randomly at 1 a.m, I'll probably respond to it. I love talking about this stuff and I love teaching and all that stuff. So, is this not working? I need to turn it on. Cool. So again, it's intro to CSS and HTML. It's presented by me, Kevin Mack. Nice transition is my handle, which a lot of people make fun of me for that one, but it seems to, I don't know, because a lot of times you're like, oh, that was a nice transition, like moving from one place to another, and then like someone like snickers about it. But I just had that domain name for maybe about 12 years now. So what I want to do and kind of get started, Adam did an introduction to myself. I have an introduction slide on myself, and I know I kind of reached out to all of you, but I don't think, my guess is some of you probably know each other, but if we could go around and kind of do a quick introduction of your name, kind of your knowledge of HTML, CSS, and where you work, and kind of how you define the role that you are if you're in a position, so whether you're a designer, developer, or project manager, because I've taught project managers how to do HTML and CSS. I've taught .NET guys, Java guys, HTML and CSS. Then I've taught HTML and CSS developers, HTML and CSS. So I've taught like a wide range of people and kind of go in depth. And if there's anything that I'm saying that I try to hold back from getting too techy on some things and trying to explain, but if there's anything that I say, like any acronym or anything at all, just literally raise your hand at that moment and we can disrupt. We'll go over at the outline. So if there's something that you ask and I'm like, oh, we'll hit on that later. Hopefully we do hit on it. If I don't, like literally they just throw a rock at me and I'll respond to it.
Where are the rocks?
You have to go outside first and then bring one in and hopefully it's not too pointy. All right, so, and thanks for the introductions. And again, disrupt, hopefully you guys become friends. Not going to encourage you guys to party after today, but I'm sure I'm going to encourage that because I want us all to kind of become friends. So giving an introduction to myself, I like to say I get excited and make things. I currently work at Cardinal Solutions as a consultant, so working under UX as well as custom application development, some really awesome companies. Columbus Web Group, Adam and I started it now 2 years ago. Did a bunch of different educational things when we were working together at Resource, and that's kind of where it was derived from. My buddies and I started a group online called RAD, which stands for Ridiculously Awesome Developers. There's a couple different names for it, but I think that's where we landed on. It's a group on Facebook, and I'd recommend looking it up. It's r.a.d. And it's one of the best places to find information on what's going on in technology as a whole, not just development. It's a bunch of geeks just geeking out. But there are a lot of non-developers and tech people in there just because it's turned into a really nice group. And that's been going on now for about 4 years. I'm part of Civic Hacks, and you guys don't know what Civic Hacks is. Not going to get too far into it, but we are basically right now looking at people in Columbus that are entrepreneurs that have stories to tell. So those individual people that have done really great things for the community, trying to capture their story and share it, and hopefully make Columbus continue to grow. So I'm really passionate about Columbus and retention of our designers and developers here. That's one of our big things with Columbus Web Group too. And then I've worked on a bunch of open source projects. I started development in 95. I think I, around maybe 97, I had my first client, and it was building websites that were just based around content. So back then, there wasn't much you could do. It was just like, I need a website, I need a .com, because that was when people started having like actual real internet at home. And at that time, like, the internet was very boring. It was literally just all based around content. And I'm going to kind of go over my view of like the website as a whole, and kind of pulled some slides together from other presentations I've done, and then based around the feedback that you guys did, added some additional things. And this isn't going to be a presentation like me standing up here talking, but today is going to be a little bit more on the presentational slide, and then we'll be hitting on these as we go through and kind of do some live coding stuff. Yeah, and then from kind of the early, I mean, the mid-90s, I started getting into e-commerce, as well as I was then hired to work on a client side. So I worked at MI Homes, and I came in as a developer, but it was really confusing to everyone that I worked with, because I was the first developer that was hired on the marketing team. And the marketing team didn't really understand like what I was. They're like, so are you a designer? I was like, no, I'm kind of a developer, but I can also design. So I started doing like InDesign, InDesign, and did a couple spreads for the dispatch. So I actually did print design for a while there, which was really awesome. The developers in the IT side, they didn't get me because they thought I was just a marketing designer. And my role kind of evolved to be this glue in between IT and marketing. And then kind of from there, the industry was also growing as a whole. And that trend kind of continued throughout my career, where I was like this person between like marketing and IT, even working at the agency, the creatives versus the technologists, and trying to open up the bridge for communication and collaboration from different sides of the spectrum. So over the years, I've got to work with some crazy awesome clients. So this is just a kind of list of them. I've worked with way more than this, but this is just the classic like client slide. So I was mentioned in Ad Age for a campaign that I did for Purina Cat Chow, which was this campaign's still going on. It's I'm a cat person. So cat person was a hashtag. We were given 72 hours to come up with a campaign as well as a technology solution for how we could display tweets in Times Square. And at the time, I can't remember what year it was, but it was really, you know, Twitter was still kind of relatively new, and that idea hadn't been done before, and it was a really, really awesome. I meant to actually grab some slides from that, because it was really cool to see it. So you sent in a tweet, and then we had people that were on it 24/7 that were approving the tweets, and depending on where you were in the cycle, you'd see your tweet show up at Times Square, but then you would get a picture of your tweet in Times Square, and you get mentioned back with your image being sent back to you. So that was a really cool project. And then I did the first, my buddy and I worked on it when we were at Resource, was the first quick service restaurant mobile payment solution, which was a hybrid application written in Backbone. And we had to come, and that was for Wendy's, and we had to come up with a solution for, I think they had 15,000 different POS systems, their point of sale, because of how big that company is. We had to come up with a solution that would work to do mobile payment through a hybrid application. Hybrid means that you write one code base, but it can be deployed in Android, iOS, and Windows phones, I guess, for Michael, the one user. But
dozens of us.
Yeah, and other different things that I've done, they're not really that important for this, but I've been doing this for a really long time, and I really love it as a whole. So, I emailed all of you, and I think I got a response from everyone. Did everyone respond to my email, see my email, about what you want to get out of this class? I'm not 100% sure if it was 100%. I should have counted that. It would have only been 10 to count. But this was kind of the breakdown of everything that I had. So, there was a lot of overlap with what you guys were saying and what you wanted to get out of the class. And one of the things with the weekend workshops is these aren't predefined classes. They're based off of you guys, and I'm putting together an outline. But if, you know, my plan's to go this way and you guys want to go this way, we can go that way. One of the big things is the width front end. It is a huge umbrella, and I'll be talking about that in a second. I really do want to just stick on the topic of HTML and CSS as a whole, because if we go down the path of JavaScript, I can talk about that for 24 hours straight. So we are going to be doing other workshops for more specific things. So the common topics I heard was getting a knowledge of CSS and HTML, just the syntax and like the way to talk about HTML and CSS, as well as how to start it. What selectors are and the different types of them, like classes versus ID. So we'll definitely dive into that through some examples. How designers and developers are working together, and overall workflow and process for developing, as well as working in a team. The lingo to talk to devs, I like that one. I don't know who said that one. That was you? Yeah, cool. I think put that almost word for word there. How to create innovative experiences. This one we won't necessarily get into, but I'm hoping like through talking about process as a whole that and how to scale projects that will kind of come up, and at least you can derive how to think about the bigger picture. Performance, so how performant the code is, and that's definitely going to be a topic that we talk about. Starting a project, I kind of said that. Resources on so where to go to learn additional things, and positioning and layout, which that kind of makes sense. That was one of the things that was called out in the description, as well as styles, theming, and then whoever said specificity gets like a super golden star. But that is definitely something that we're going to talk about. If you guys don't know what it is, that's something that you'll walk away with today. And then responsive web design, and we're not going to go like super deep into responsive web design, but we'll be talking on it, and at least the best practice for it and an introduction to it for those that don't know what it is. So from there, I derived this list. And I say the word derived too much. I was really into calculus. The funny thing is I was in calculus 2 my sophomore year of high school, and then I took a couple years off, and by my senior year I was just like, whatever. And I ended up getting the worst grade ever. And one test, like, the teacher just really, pissed me off. So I drew a picture on it and handed it in. I don't know why I did that. And it was my first and only F that I ever got. But I thought I was being creative. So I put together this outline. I really showed her, you know. Fuck you. So... team dynamics. So it's going to actually go from the left. So we're going to talk about team dynamics and kind of the roles in the umbrella of front end as well as UX. And then we're going to talk about web development and the modern web. So what really is a website, and talk about responsive web design inside there. So the modern web, as well as something I like to bring up is contextual experience design, project process, syntax of CSS. And this is where we'll get into more of like the live coding. So hopefully I don't bore you for these first couple bullets here, but they're more presentational and also interactive. And then we'll talk about dev tools, so using Chrome as a way to develop and design. We'll talk about inheritance, which is kind of related to specificity as a whole too. We'll talk about these three methodologies, and these three methodologies kind of changed the way that I approached developing and designing HTML and CSS, and they're all related really to object-oriented CSS as a whole. So that's BEM, which stands for Block Element Modifier, Atomic Design, which is amazing, and ITCSS, or ITCSS. It's a relatively new methodology or approach for crafting sites as a whole, so it's actually developed by Harry Roberts from CSS Wizardry. And he goes back and forth between saying it and IT CSS. So that's why I don't really know what the right way it is. And it's really hard to find information on it CSS right now because he's currently developing it in a whole. But even though it's kind of still maturing, it's still a really great way of thinking about approaching websites. And then, of course, we're getting into positioning of websites. And through that, we'll talk about styling and theming as a whole. So any questions? Is there anything in here that people really want to see? Because when I'm done like mentoring and like talking, someone always like raises their hand and they're like, can we also throw in Git? I'm like, that doesn't really fit, but it kind of does make sense, especially if you're new to development. Working with a repository or something like Git is usually a good seeing if we can slide it in there. Anything missing? Anything that sounds horrible? Are you guys being quiet? Yeah, what's up? Yeah, so we're just going to talk about more of the methodology, so what atomic design is. So it's really just an approach for building scaling sites. But we'll dive into that. Are you familiar with it?
No, I'm not.
Okay.
It
yeah.
Sounds really cool.
Yeah. It is actually a really complex topic as a whole, and you can probably I could definitely do a full course on atomic design, but what I'll cover on it should be the basis for you to kind of move forward with it. So looking at team dynamics, and I'm actually going to whiteboard and I almost grabbed the Sharpie. Let me guess, I'm going to pick the one that doesn't work. Is there a black one? So in this industry, we have an issue with understanding who people are and what their roles are as a whole. And the biggest issue is what a front-end developer is, as well as nowadays what a UX person is. And UX as a whole, or user experience like team, or UXD, or UDF, or ED for experience design, which is my least favorite. These are umbrellas. So UX is an umbrella, as well as front-end. So kind of looking at a spectrum, and I talk to different recruiters, because they're always like, I'm trying to hire a front-end developer. I'm like, well, what type of front-end developer? They're like, front-end developer, but they don't realize that that's just a spectrum. So what I like is, and let me know if you can't see this, but it says front-end, right? And what I like to do is put on one side an application architect. That's a variation for architect, because I was going to misspell probably both of those words. And then on the other side, I like to put a UI dev or developer. So this, for me, is the umbrella for front end. So you have the spectrum that goes here. And then this is a vertical, so from here to here. And when I'm looking at and interviewing people, I'm always looking at someone that is right here. And this is like, if you're in this vertical, you're an expert on application development. And what that means is that you do JS, things like Node, you do integration, you're building MVSTAR, integration, MVC framework, so your backbones, your Angulars, and all those things in there. So that's the person that is still doing front-end technology, which front-end breaks down to be HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, right? So those are the main breakdowns. But you can be more on this side and kind of fall over here, or you can be more on this side. But HTML is kind of just always in the middle. And a really interesting article came out last week. They said HTML is done. And they don't mean that it's done, because when I saw that, it was like link bait. And I was like, HTML's not done. What they meant is the spec for it. So there's W3C org, and there's some other consortiums out there, which the web's open source. So each item, element that's being developed for the web, anyone's able to contribute to it and help develop the ideas behind it. So HTML's reached a point where they say it's done, because it is referred to as one of the most stable languages of all time, and they really don't need to add anything to it. And over the past couple of years, they've added a few additional specs in there, like an HTML5. I think the most useful one that's come out is like the detail one, so it has some interaction with it. But they're trying to say that it's done, because HTML is now starting to get into these weird elements that have experiences attached to them. But that's not what HTML was really all about. And then CSS is the styling for it, and this is over here. So this person is the master of CSS as well as interfaces. Well, this person doesn't have to be a designer, because I've worked with and currently work with some really awesome UI developers. So user interface is what I mean by UI. So it's what you see when you go to a website. It's the actual face of the website as a whole. So when you go there, you see a button, you see like a grid of some sort and a breakdown. That's what this person's like the master of. Some of these people have no design skill at all. They're just a master of CSS, and they can take your design and make it come to life in the browser. So this is another vertical. A lot of people, when they say front end, I feel like they're just hitting here, which they have a little bit of CSS knowledge, and they can do some interfaces, and they can do a little bit of JavaScript as a whole. But, you know, that gets you, like, you know, you can say that you're a front-end developer by doing that. But in reality, it's like you need to decide as you're learning to either go over here and over here, because in the front-end world, there's something new coming out almost every single day. And trying to keep up with the JavaScript world and being more of like an architect oversight and integrating into services on the back end, it gets really complicated. Like, the JavaScript world right now is so unsettled. It's like the storm of who knows what's going on, and I try to keep up with it, but it's like a nightmare right now. But it's really exciting to see what's happening. CSS has been pretty stable. There's a new, so right now it's CSS 3, and those are just based off the different levels. So there's a bunch of new specs coming out, which is going to be CSS level 4. So CSS 4 is coming out here soon, which is going to just include additional selectors. So as a whole, CSS is pretty stable. Yep.
So really, you don't want to stay in the middle of the spectrum.
You can specialize, and it's really great to, as I said, like to be both ways. But as a whole, especially like if you're looking at trying to make a career in front end, you're completely fine being here, but the specialties is where, you know, you can make some serious bang. And it also, like, won't give you a nightmare. And I used to have to explain to people, like, well, I really just like building interfaces. And they're like, well, can you also do some JavaScript? I was like, sure. But I like to stay on this side of the spectrum, even though I'm still following everything that's out there. It's just a lot to absorb. But ideally, as a front-end developer, you have at least the core and the basis of it. And in this class, you know, we're definitely just hitting on more of like this side of the spectrum.
Right.
And there's going to be other classes where we are hitting more here, and then other ones that are just here. And then I'm sure we'll probably do, and this one would be a little bit harder to stay just on the building an interface. That may be one if we do like an atomic design based off pattern lab. So then on the other side of this, I have this other umbrella. I'm not going to put it kind of like as front end. And then, so this is its own little vertical, and that's a whole other story. But then down here is more of the visual designer. So the visual designer could also do some UI stuff, but I like to separate those out. And on projects where I've asked to be a designer and a developer on, I'm always like, I don't want to do that, because one side is going to win over the other. It's just how your mind works. It's near impossible. You're going to either limit the design that you're doing to meet the technology needs, or you're going to limit the technology, or I don't know. It's just really hard to do it. You can do it, but it just makes it a lot more difficult to break it down. So looking at UX, there's different spectrums of UX. And you can be a front-end UX developer. So UX stands for user experience. So you're focused on the user as a whole and building out the experiences that people are interacting with in your website. And inside there's different spectrums, and it's kind of hard to like put it out. And again, it's a large topic, and it's a relatively newer term in this industry, and it's a really great term. We used to always rely on the visual designer to do the experiences, or like your business analyst, so like your BA, or in your information architect, so your IAs out there, which there's different IAs that could be also a UX person. So UX is just, you focus on the overall experience. But to me, I like to break it as its own role because, as I said, you could be a UX visual designer, you could be a UX front-end developer, you can be a UX BA, UX IA, you can just be a UX research, doing research and running focus groups, doing audits on websites. Accessibility also falls into UX as a whole. So there's different spectrums inside there. But what I like to call out is the visual designer. And why I think this still works is to break it out and kind of put, you know, UX in the middle. A lot of times you do have this person here, so a visual designer that does UX. But I like to look at people that are also just a vertical that are really awesome designers that
understand the web and have knowledge of these other things, but they're just focused on it. And then on the other spectrum is your backend guys, which inside the backend, I also include like people that are working like DBA, so people that are working on database administration as a whole, so the data people. Backends like your .NET, Java. Why can't I think of any other ones? PHP.
Node.js.
That's a tough one. But yeah, you can use Node.js there, I guess.
So.
Yeah, I guess so. So you can have a front end person that does back end. But again, I see this as its own vertical. So inside project process, I'll kind of talk about this as a whole. I see multiple people having different roles on projects as a whole. So having a visual designer, having a UX person, having a UI dev, having a application architect, and a backend person. And then they're all working together, and they're all kind of masters of their own craft as a whole. But a lot of times, like, you know, this role may be shared, like, the visual designer may also be doing running the UX as a whole, and then the UI person may also be helping out with the user experience. But these are the real important things to separate out, because when you try to take on both of these roles of being the UI, creating the interface, and the application architect, it's the same issue of being the UI person as well as the visual designer, because that the complexity of that is going to take away from the time of this. Unless you have an unlimited amount of time and an unlimited amount of budget to just kind of move forward, it's better to separate them out. And everyone works in parallel and working together. So then the application architect, these are more closely related because they're developing the solutions that could then be integrated in, so how the interface is going to be tied to the data that's coming in. So any questions on that? That's kind of a quick little overview of that. Yeah. I'm sorry? Interaction designer? I would say that's a really tricky one these days, but I would say that's somewhere like maybe in between here. You know? And it may be even more of a branch out because it depends on what you mean by interactive designer. What are you referring to?
It's basically something really.
Yeah. Well, if you're still using something like Flash or some of those other languages that have popped up that are more like frameworks to develop interactions as a whole, I would say that's more of a branch out. But if you're talking about like an interactive visual designer, I would say that they are like right here still. So still put on the visual designer. Does this make sense? Am I talking crazy? Okay, cool. So then I also have this version up here, just to kind of go over it, but I decided to draw it up there. Whoop. Whoop. I love Keynote. So that's kind of the spectrum, and when I'm referring to different roles inside of it, this is kind of like base setting as a whole. And again, I struggle for people to understand the front-end world. And sometimes I'm just like, why can't you get it? There's like different roles, there's different skill sets. And when I relate front end to back end, it starts clicking too. So if I'm like, we know the server side language of the back end is in .NET, we wouldn't be like, let's put the Java guy on this to write the back end. But in front end world, you'll take the CSS wizard and make him do the application architect and the JavaScript. And it never really works out that well. I'm sorry? Wait, are you agreeing or disagreeing with me?
No, I agree with you.
Okay, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, and that's the biggest issue with the front end world right now. And I think it's just because it's grown. As I said, like when I was working at MI, no one really understood what a front end, and front end didn't even exist. The term, we were called, it was developers, and then it was client side developers,
which that confused everyone, but that was the industry term for front-end developers, which client just meant the browser as a whole. And then somewhere someone said the word front-end, and then it kind of just kicked off from there. Do you know the history of where the word front-end came from? Outer space. So the world of the web, I love this slide. Every time I've used this in a presentation and I say this, I don't know what it is, but it literally looks like it says Wayne's World to me. Like,
yeah, it's the colors.
Yeah, I doesn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
But it clearly says World of Web, which is also like a weird phrase that I put together slides really late at night, and I'm usually drinking. So World of Web, here we go. So what is a website? I'm just kind of curious, just shout out, how do you guys define a website? What's your 10-second definition of a website? That's my favorite one so far. All right, cool. So when you actually look up what a website is and like do a Google search on it and even go to Wikipedia, which is where you find out where everything is, it is one of the most complex definitions of all time, and it gets super techie. It's like human interactions with a hardware computer, which computers were made by. And it's like, I don't know, what is that? Like if it wasn't so like engraved in our everyday life, we'd be really confused what a website is. It just kind of exists now. But this workshop, I am going to define it as content, UI, which again stands for user interface, and UX. And I put content there because, as I said, like when I started developing websites and why websites exist, it's to put your content out there. And you know, we definitely did some crazy things around the web 2.0 era. Who's familiar with that phrase? Good. I won't bring it up then. But I would like to break it down into this, like, content plus creating an interface that people can work with, and then engaging, the users with the interface to bring the content in the right priority as a whole. So I just say, to me, a website's content, UI, UX, and I kind of throw away everything else there. And there's a lot of other moving pieces in it. But again, to align with this workshop, I'm defining it as that. And I had a note, and like I remember saying that to someone, and they were like, well, isn't it also .NET? And I was like, don't ever say that again to me. So where do websites live? This is one of my favorite graphics of all time, and I literally use this in almost every client presentation when I'm talking about responsive or the current landscape of the web. So I like to use the phrase digital landscape, and some people are like, what does that mean? So this is what I'm referring to as the digital landscape. This is an image that was created by Luke Rabuski from LukeW.com. Do you guys know who Luke W is? Luke W is one of our industry leaders, and he has been for a really long time. I've seen him speak, and I would highly suggest looking up, following him, reading his blog. He's an incredible designer, thinker, one of the people that has moved this industry really forward. But he put together this graphic, which it first layer up here, it shows smartphones to desktop, so this whole spectrum of small devices to large devices. The next is where people are interacting with them. So more of like the context of how people are using these devices. So you see a smartphone is traditionally in your palm. I feel like this could now be added like watches once the browser gets in there, if we're looking at this in more of a mobile sense. But how people are interacting with it, palm, the lap, the desk. So the different places where people are interacting with this. And that's really important. It's key to when you're thinking about building an interface as a whole. And then these other interactions that happen, so touch gestures. And when this graphic first came out, and it's a couple years old now, the idea that touch went all the way to the desktop like blew people's minds. They're like, what? No, that's impossible. But now over the years, we've seen more and more devices are coming out from the desktop that have touch capabilities. Ali has one in his at his house, and I've played with it, and it's really, really awesome. And of course, like the tablets have it and smartphones. But where people go wrong is they make this horrible assumption that once devices or my screen size gets smaller, and this is related to responsive, which I'll touch on, but once my screen size gets smaller, I now have the capability of touch because my iPhone has touch. Well, there's a lot of devices that are still out there that don't have touch capabilities that are just small, or if I have a small browser window on my desktop, I can't just make the assumption on screen size that touch is now available. So the idea of all these is just thinking about the context of where people are interacting with your interface in your site that you're building and the code that you're doing, and making sure that you have thought like, well, if touch is available, how will people actually be able to interact with it? If touch isn't available, how will they be able to interact with it? And like, I've done a lot of mobile design work and hybrid applications, and one of the big callouts is all CTAs are call to actions, and I say CTAs all the time. And again, if I say any acronym or abbreviation, abrevs, please raise your hand. So now I forgot what I was going to say. Like call to actions on mobile devices, because the average size of a finger is between 38 and 44 pixels. So they say all call to actions should be 40 pixels high and at least 40 pixels wide. So when you're building out an interface, you want to make sure that you're taking that into account. And sometimes like I'll make an update to an interface and I liked how it looked before, and then I'm like, oh, shit, I didn't make that area clickable. And I was like, but it looks so nice. And then I have to like change it around and like update some of the spacing on other things. And I'm like, you know what? It works. And that's all that matters, is that it works. And then it was probably just because I was kind of getting my blinders on. I was too used to it. And then the keyboard, which is really awesome.
You say that needs to be like a hold button or just the amount of space that you're allocating?
The amount of space around it. So a lot of times I fake it with like putting transparency around it. It's just the clickable region. So there's some hackery and tricks that you can do to make it not look like, yeah, so you don't have like a line of text and all of a sudden like a link and then a line of text. There's different ways of doing it. Keyboard cursors, and that includes both the digital, real tactile ones versus, you know, the digital ones out there. So this is a great graphic. When you're talking about the web, I love talking about the digital landscape. So as we think about interfaces and also building out CSS and HTML, that this is always in the back of your head, that you're thinking about the different contexts and all the variable factors that are out there for users. And then, I love this. So, who are websites for?
Us, users.
Yeah! So, users. And I'm a huge UX nerd as a whole, and literally, I've done presentations on buttons for clients that talked about an individual call to action button for an hour and why it was designed and placed that way based off of research, as well as like the coloring and the overall page flow. So every single piece of an interface to me needs to have a story, and it also needs to be related back to the user and why we're building the website. Generally, users want to be connected and they want consistent experiences, right? And as web developers, designers, it's really up to us to kind of create those consistent experiences and making sure that we're not forgetting why we're making websites. To me, you're serving content to users out there, and you're doing it through user experience and the interfaces that you're building. So web development. I'm going to play a short clip here. It's 2 minutes long. Is everyone awake? Am I being boring yet? I should have said, am I being boring? Yet, yeah. So, and if you guys also need a break, we'll take a break here in about 10 minutes. So I'm gonna just get through another section, and you know, if you have to use the restroom, more coffee, I definitely need it, or water. So, this video that I'm gonna be playing here is Harry Roberts, and he's CSS Wizardry. He is one of the best people to follow out there when it comes to building front-end solutions. Just as I said, Luke W. or Luke Rabuski, so lukew.com. CSSWizardry.com is one of the best sources. And Harry Roberts, he did Inuit, which is a CSS framework as a whole, which is one of the only ones that I would say is a solid one. And hopefully I bring this up later, but I'll say it now, just in case if I forget. Yes?
You said lukew.com?
Yeah, lukew.com and CSS Wizardry. And then nice transition. but this guy's brilliant, and he's come up with a lot of methodologies, and he's been able to dissect, and I've been following him for years, and he's matured a lot over the past couple years, which I think there's been a lot of, as I said, like JavaScript's been kind of in flux recently. There was a lot of craziness that was going on with CSS and like the browser wars as a whole, and we'll be talking about responsive, but I feel like responsive web and the proliferation of mobile technology and the better modern browser has allowed us to be a little bit more stable these days. So this guy's awesome. I'm going to play this, and hopefully it's loud enough where we can hear it. So he is just going to be talking about CSS as a whole.
If anyone works on a product like CSS, it's got really hairy, you know, it's got just, oh, who did this? Why did you do this? That happens on almost any project, but it gets a lot worse when we start writing large products, when we start writing large UIs. Now, there are a lot of problems with CSS. CSS is terrible, which is why I've managed to make a living out of writing it. If it was easy, I wouldn't have a job. But there are two main camps, right? Two main divides I find in the problems with CSS. There are things that CSS gets wrong, and CSS fundamentally makes some mistakes. But we as developers get things wrong all the time. We do some really silly things with CSS. So there are two broad categories. There are things that CSS gets wrong, there are things that we get wrong. Looking at things that are potentially CSS's fault, the first one seems like the weirdest, the cascade and inheritance. Now that's a key foundation of how CSS works. You know, it's one of CSS's biggest features. But I'm sure you've worked on a code base where you've edited a rule here and it's just broken something on a page like 100 clicks away. That's because CSS operates in this global namespace where everything cascades and inherits, and every bit of CSS has got the potential to affect something else. It can't be fully encapsulated. So the cascade inheritance is a really leaky, horrible way of working at scale. And it's very loose. So CSS is nice and easy to learn, which is good. You can just view source and a beginner can pick up how to write CSS. That's really nice for the web, but it's not nice for developers, mature developers. You can't write CSS in a strict mode. There isn't a way of turning on a strict version of CSS. So it's really easy to do nasty things with CSS, and that can be the developer's fault, and it's also CSS's fault for allowing it. Very highly dependent on source order. Right? I mean, a lot of languages are, but CSS is very highly dependent on source order because things cascade in a certain way, and I'm sure you've tried moving a rule set around a style sheet, and it's broken everything. So even just moving existing CSS around can break a lot of stuff, so we need a way of managing source order effectively. It's not very expressive. It's a really dull, boring syntax. You know, color, colon, red. It's just boring and dull. But as a result, it doesn't tell much of a story. When you try and read someone else's CSS, it's very hard to understand what they were achieving. It's not very expressive at all, which is why we should probably write more documentation. Lots of gotchas. There are some just frankly weird things in CSS that we just can't avoid. CSS is just bizarre. And I've said the best to last. Specificity. Specificity is the worst aspect of CSS because it doesn't matter what cascades to where or what order you've written things in. Specificity can undo everything. Who's ever had like problems with specificity on a project? You know, selectors that are way too specific.
So, could you guys understand him through that crazy accent that he has? I should have gave warning, like put on your like, I don't know, interpreter maybe. But so what he's talking about here is CSS. You know, and this is a great talk, and I can send you guys a link to it. But a lot of times, you know, there's a lot of things at fault for CSS as a whole, and a lot of people have looked at CSS as just like, oh, this is really, really easy language. Anyone can do it. My .NET guy will write the interface. And because of that, and there, I would say, like, almost lack of respect and understanding of CSS has led to so many issues with projects as a whole. That's why you see so many broken things as you're out there. So one of the things that I really want you guys to take away is, like, these CSS faults in this class, I want us to be hitting on each of these points here. So, again, we'll be talking about inheritance, and I'm going to, after we take a break, that's going to be where we're really hitting on what inheritance means, as well as specificity. So how many of you guys actually know what that is? And I've said it a bunch of times, and he said it a bunch of times, which we may have to rewatch this video at the end, maybe at the end of week three, so some of this will make more sense to you. Some of it may just sound like jargon, but to me, I'm like, ha-ha, great. And these other pieces. So specificity, who knows what that is?
Is this the point that the more specific thing it's selecting for, that's what
it's doing? Yes. Primarily, it's adding additional context to the code that you're writing. And what this means is, and we'll be diving into this more, so I have a selector. And if you don't know what this means, we'll be hitting on this after we get back from break. And then I have, this is called this foo. And then I have another selector that's a.bar. And then I have my curly brackets with my CSS properties inside here. So specificity means it's looking at this. So we have to have a element inside our HTML that has a class of bar. That item has to be an anchor. And somewhere inside the overall code, relating from the hierarchy of the code, there needs to be a foo and a some other class called selector. So looking at it, specificity is relating to all these selectors targeting down to this individual anchor or a tag.
So it's like you had an unordered list and you want to specify the actual list. That's what you want to change, right?
Yeah. So primarily, and the takeaway is, like, this is wrong. You should never think of it this way, and we'll definitely be hitting on this. And through demos that I'll be showing you in just a few minutes, this will make sense. But specificity means that you have this long grouping that's targeting an individual element or a group of elements that have to follow this pattern. It has to have a selector, it has to have foo, it has to have an anchor that has bar as a class. So right now that may seem like gibberish to you, but that's basically what specificity is. It's adding complexity to your selectors, and you are really focusing on an individual piece by targeting it. It's over, not qualifying, but over declaring what you're actually trying to target here. Yep.
So this kind of like focuses down onto a single object. Did it work the other way too, where you had like just foo within something? Would that be able to apply like a smaller amount of whatever your CSS styling is?
What do you mean by that?
Like almost like a filtering system, like your specific object would be selector foo a bar. Would you have another thing that would apply something like foo? Anything that has foo in it would get this CSS applied to it?
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's something that we're going to hit on. That's what I thought you meant. I just wanted to make sure before I said yes or no. So what we're going to do is I'm going to go over some web assumptions, and then when we come back, we're going to, I mean, after I get through this, we're going to take a little break here and then get over it, actually get in some code and some syntax and explain things like this. So web dev assumptions, 5 minutes, time out. So web dev assumptions. So these are kind of not sarcastic, but these are assumptions that we make as we're writing code as a whole. And there's just three that I'm hitting on, but there's a million more that I could bring up. And this is just really related to as we dive into selectors as well as specificity and inheritance as a whole, and also project management. So the code is quality, which this is sarcastic as a whole. this is an assumption that we make that the code is quality. You inherit a project that's already in flight, and you start diving in there. And then you realize that the backend guy that knows CSS has been writing the whole interface. And you're like, I don't even know what this does. And you start going through all of your tools that you have, and you eventually get to the point where you're like, I just need to scrap it. It'd be way quicker than me trying to fix it. Or they're over-declaring something in one spot. They're not looking at the over-cascading effects of CSS. And I'll explain what that means. But pretty much CSS means it reads from the top to the bottom. And as you write your code for CSS, you're supposed to go more global and widespread and target all the way down and get more specific as you go down. So code is quality is a horribly flawed logic when you think you're going to get started on a project. A lot of the projects that I do, I recommend doing a discovery, which is a tech discovery where we do a code audit before we really even can do an estimate. And I overestimate on projects because of the quality of code. And that's one of the big things is I'm huge into best practice standards for writing code and making sure that's scalable over time. Second, well, I guess I have more slides on here. Oh, yeah. I kind of just put these together, these slides, and I didn't really practice this. So if I have some hiccups like that, don't hate me. So a lot of times I always hear just update that. And I'm like, I'm not even on the project. Someone's like, can you just help us update that? It's like, it's not working. Can you make it look like how it's supposed to look or act? So someone in every project says that. And this just like, oh, that doesn't, that's not how it works. Like, you need a plan and work for it. And they're like, no, man, it's just a little change. It won't affect anything. And you're like, no, okay. So you get in there and you write some actually good quality code. And you're like, I don't know where to stick this. So I'll just stick it at the bottom where you're supposed to be more specific on my CSS. And then you go from the home page, it's fixed on the home page, you go to the about page, and then everything's broken. And you're like, damn it. So that's something that like really puts me over the edge when it goes back to the quality of code. It also, without having quality of code, it becomes a maintenance and scaling nightmare. So people are always like, just get it done really fast. And I'm like, well, I can't get it done really fast. Is this ever going to have to be updated? Is anyone else going to have to look at this really quickly? Like, I can knock this out really fast, like 5 minutes, but that's probably not good for the long term of this project. It'll take me 15 minutes. And then getting on assumption two, nothing will change. This is one of the basis of like BEM, is methodology for writing CSS and HTML. So and we'll definitely be talking about this. It's awesome. So in the example, and this is actually a quote from BEM.com or a block of code. It says, website development process is based on the assumption that the design and technical requirements will not change. So based off of that as a whole, BEM was kind of derived from it. And then to continue some information from BEM, stands for block element modifier. This only works if the only thing that's changing is the content on a website. But that, of course, is usually not happening. And from concept, so initial thinking of a project, to it's actually being deployed and integrated into the system, websites change. And it's a good thing that they change. So really, how to deal with this, and I will say this a bunch of times, sustainable systems that are flexible to meet the ever-growing needs of a project's demands. So as you look at a project, you're designing for something today, but you need to be designing and thinking about the unknown as you're writing your code and as you're planning and designing and creating experiences. One of which ways to do it is to think of, you're not designing websites as a whole, you're not designing pages, but you're designing a system of components that work well together. They're puzzle pieces that individually are the actual finished product, but work and play well together. So a system of components that are designed together. That's fine. And this is a quote by Stephen Hay. So again, don't be thinking about, I want to design the about page. Think about breaking it into different sections and chunks. And then you can take those sections and chunks and make them even into more pieces. So break websites into modules. And I say modules a lot. Modules refers to zones or individual pieces of the interface. Am I boring you?
No.
Yeah. I will probably make fun of each one of you, but I'll make fun of myself the most. And if Adam was sitting here and he wasn't hungover, I'd be making fun of him now. Ben Callahan, he's one of my favorite people, and he runs Sparkbox, and he said this, modularity is a requirement of maintainable systems. And I think this is a brilliant, brilliant quote. I quote this quote a bunch of times. It's a brilliant quote. So when you're thinking about projects as a whole, whether you're a designer or developer, or you know, you're just interested, thinking about this is really important, creating maintainable systems that are modular. So the third one that I'm going to talk about, we know what that does. So it's kind of related to the other two, but you open up the code base and you're like, I see my selector names, I see my DOM. They're two separate things, and I'm like, I know what that does. And you make this horrible assumption that I'm going to update this guy, and then I'm going to be moving on, and I'm going to go over to Starbucks and have a coffee. And in reality, a lot of times, you don't really know what that does in the world of CSS and HTML, and you make this assumption, like, this really won't affect anything. And then I update something, and then we go back to the about page, and then all the text is like red or something. And you're like, I wasn't even using that property, but for some reason, we broke the whole website. We shut the whole thing down. So these assumptions will be our basis of the way that I like to think about and not approach web design and development, and also the basis of a lot of the methodologies that we'll be talking about in future classes. So what we're going to do is take a 5-minute break. And I do have a couple more slides that I kind of forgot the order on. And I talked about responsive already a bunch of times. And just to set that, continue to set this baseline for the rest of this course, I want to talk about this as a whole because it's really important as we're thinking about creating modular systems as well as writing really awesome CSS. All right. Getting back into where we kind of left off, and I said responsive, and I'm going to touch on this really quickly because this is, again, probably its own topic, and I say that about a lot. And if you guys have suggestions, we have 27 people already talked to, and we're planning out what those topics will be. But we don't really have priority to them. We're actually doing an instructor a couple evenings to kind of get everyone aligned with the way that we want to approach these and also the classes that they want to teach. But we have 27 people already aligned with it. So if there's a topic that is really burning that you want to hear about, let me know, or Adam. So what is RWD, or responsive web design? Quick show of hands, who's familiar with responsive web design? Cool. So responsive web design, it was coined by Ethan Marcotte in a May 2010 Alista Part article. And from that moment, it kind of like turned the industry on the side. And you know how we talked about the digital landscape earlier? It's creating an interface that can adapt change based off different contexts of how a user is going to be interacting with the website as a whole. So one of the definitions I like the best is from Wikipedia, actually. And I jokingly talk about Wikipedia all the time. But what I like about this, it says it's an approach for crafting sites to provide the optimal viewing experiences across a wide range of devices. So I like to say crafting sites across the digital landscape. And it's just an approach for designing as well as developing. And as I said earlier, like in that spectrum that we had here, front end, because of responsive web, we kind of were required to have people that really understood interfaces as well as CSS to create these really robust systems that could scale to meet the demands of whatever the browser had capabilities or limitations of. So one of the first limitations that people really focus on was size. Adam's seen this quote before, but people often say when they're thinking about responsive web design as a squishy page. So
did I really say that?
Yeah, you did. The source is a conversation I had, so down there at the bottom with him. Adam and I, like, believe it or not, we get drinks and then we dork out about stuff, and then his wife's like, so
she usually just leaves me somewhere.
I believe it. But you know, you see a lot of people doing this like hand gesture, and they're talking about the website getting smaller. That's okay. So that's a brief definition. So as a browser gets smaller, it's creating the interface is going to adapt or change around the restrictions of the design. So it allows you to have this fluid design, one code base that's written in HTML and CSS that's surrounded around the content, so the interface and the experience that is based around different contexts of the users. So small screens, you're able to design the mobile view, the quote-unquote mobile view, as well as the desktop view, as well as the tablet view with one code base. So they use a thing called media queries, and we'll talk about this throughout the workshop. That's kind of the quick definition of what it is. For the people that aren't familiar with responsive, does that definition at least add some kind of direction of what responsive is? You can speak up if it doesn't. So it's just making it kind of scale and making the content accessible no matter what device you're on. Luke Rabuski, as I brought up earlier, Luke W., he said responsive web design was relying too much on screen as a whole, so that squishy page. And I don't like to say mobile, tablet, desktop. I like to refer to it as the digital landscape as a whole. So how no matter what device people are using, the interface is going to work for them, and it should look as beautiful as possible. So as developers and designers, we started really focusing on size as a whole, and we made assumptions, as I talked about earlier, like touch devices. Once the screen got smaller, it was like, now we have touch capabilities. We have swipe gestures available. But we made a lot of poor decisions at the beginning, and responsive web, it got really important for looking at inheritance and specificity as a whole, and the whole idea of CSS. And I'll say this many times, when you're developing CSS, it's all about extending selectors as a whole, and you're not overriding properties. And I'll say that again, I should just write that on the board, because that's a really, really important thing. So, what did I say? C. There we go, that's an S. So, extending properties. Horrible writer. All right, so extending properties. I'm now forgetting my mind. Extending properties, not overriding. Yeah, that's the important part. What? What did I say? This is fine for right now. It's just all about extending properties and not overriding the properties too. So, values. There we go. I said that right the first time, and I said that all the time. But the second I started writing, I was like, oh, I got self-conscious. It's like when you're like, you know, you can type all day and someone stands behind you and you completely forget how to use the keyboard and you're like, That's what just happened there. It'll come back to me. So I like to say designing websites for today is more than fluid grids, flexible media, and media queries as a whole. And one of the definitions for actually responsive is that it's fluid grids, flexible media, and media queries. So we'll talk about media queries. Flexible media means that it can scale and kind of keep aspect ratios as a whole, and the containers for the content are also fluid, being able to remove width as a restriction, and the fluidness of your grids and the repositioning of content, the priority setting. So to me, it's way more than that. And the big question is, how will pieces adapt? And from that, I looked at one of the old things from visual design as a whole, which was contextual design and personalization of the web. And then I've done a lot of presentations on contextual experience design. So contextual experience design to me is the advanced responsiveness, so taking it kind of to the next level. So it's where it's not just about the device anymore, but it's really about the context and the device. And in the context of the word context here, I'm referring to how are users interacting with the device and the website or the interface that you're building. So remember in that digital landscape, there was that wide scale of small devices to large devices, but then it was like where people are using them. And to me, people get lost in the idea of what mobile is. And they immediately, when you say mobile, they think of mobile devices. But in reality, mobile is a state of a user. It's how they're interacting with it. So think about someone more of, I'm in the mobile state as opposed to I'm on my mobile device. So there's different contextual factors out there. And again, this is a its own talk. And I talk, every time I do it, it's between like 10 or 14 different ones I usually focus on. But there's a handful of them. But it's about creating personalized experiences around the user, no matter what device that they're using. So the experiences focus on the user, the user's device, and variable factors. So when I'm referring to an interface and building out things and looking at my code, I'm thinking of it not as just getting a task done, but and not just looking at the devices and the limitations and capabilities of the device. I'm looking at it as, how can we enhance the experience for the user? So that's why when I say device, I like to throw in that extra emphasis on the user and say user's device. And the variable factors are those limitations that are out there. So different browsers have capabilities and limitations that you have to design around. Responsive web works from IE9 and above in the Internet Explorer world. And that was the first HTML5 browser for Microsoft. And all the modern browsers from early days of Firefox, Safari, and Chrome support media queries. So anything that's an HTML5 browser that has CSS3 capabilities, you can actually do responsive web. And there's different variable factors based around the browser. As you're writing your code, you're not writing code for one browser, for one width, but you're writing code that is going to be across this whole landscape and these different factors. So a lot of it has to go into play. So when someone says, can you just update that? And if it's responsive, maybe you're looking at it one view and then you didn't, no one told you that was responsive, or you didn't test it on the devices and the browsers and you broke it not just visually, but the content actually isn't being displayed. Responsive is just an approach for crafting sites to make it be accessible. So with project process as a whole, I like to break it down, and I spent a long time, my last year and a half at the agency, I worked on project process, getting to touch on all different sorts of projects, and we put together an outline of how to approach projects, and it was agile, inspired, iterative, parallel, and I had it always linear. Recently, I've looked at it not in a linear sense, but more of this discover, build, and refine. So every single thing that I do, I kind of follow this, and sometimes I change out discover with maybe another word. And inside of here, it says profile, analyze, improving, enrich. And this works for both technology, the development of the code, as well as the user experience as a whole. And it's just making sure that in the case I'm writing something, I'm planning ahead. I'm discovering, you know, looking at the website, if it's a current in-flight project, what does this actually do? Getting the knowledge, talking to the other developers that have worked on it, understanding what the problem is, and then kind of crafting my solution to it right here in the build stage at the bottom, and actually starting to write the code, and then getting into more of like the quality assurance or QA and testing with the refining and looking at multiple devices. Because as I'm developing, I can show you guys my workspace too, but I have a Thunderbolt, I use my laptop, and then I have this mini USB monitor that is 408 pixels at portrait mode. So I have multiple browsers up as I'm developing, but it's really, I think it's a cool setup. But most people are just looking at it one view, and that's where the refining kind of gets in there. And especially if there's some kind of change, like a new iOS comes out, a new Android that you want to test against, that's where the refining goes in. And this has kind of kept me on track and also planning for when I'm doing projects. And there can be multiple pieces in a project. So looking at maybe the umbrella of like accessibility as a whole, there may be an accessibility or just the guidelines for creating websites that are accessible for anyone, whether you have auditory restraints as a whole, visual restraints, and the list goes on from there. But it's just making the web accessible. It's also the way that technology new inputs are actually working are based off the accessibility specs. end of day, accessibility are the guidelines for crafting really great code as well as creating really great user experiences. Do you have a question? Yeah, so in accessibility, you could think of accessibility more in a linear, and it's its own overall project. So in accessibility terms, there's different levels in accessibility. So there's level A, double A, triple A. And as you get higher, so triple A is the highest you can go, the rules become more strict. And the government websites have to be a minimum of level A, but aiming to achieve triple A, which triple A is very hard to achieve. And in the case of looking at accessibility overall, you define what your level would be, and then you would put together a strategy of how you're going to implement it inside there, which would be from a technology, content, a marketing standpoint, because it affects multiple things. Accessibility isn't just development as a whole, even though it's highly related. It's a planning process. And it directly affects the content as well as the interactions and the overall visual design. And then the refining would just be kind of going back in there and making sure that you're checking using the device's hardware out there. But within there, and looking at accessibility, so you have this umbrella accessibility, and then it has these different things. But then inside the discover or the build, you could have another one of these kind of circles that you're looking at that is just focusing on maybe contrast ratios, because that's its own little mini project. And so all these pieces are happening in parallel. And even though that is kind of linear, they're kind of all happening and rotating at their own time. And this approach has made it a lot easier for me when crafting like really large sites, because the only thing that's linear with a project is the delivery date. And if you're breaking it up into pieces, you can start focusing on the individual tasks, but know that there's, you know, the holistic overview of the project. And linear kind of breaks away also from some of the thought that needs to go into it. So I'm kind of anti, but really for wireframes. And the way that I look at wireframes, to me, looks something like this. And this is I'll show you what one of my real wireframes looks like. So I just set priority on my content. And this is really important with responsive, because I just put together like blocks. So these are my modules, like header, 1, 2, 3, zone 4, 5, and then footer. So this would be like a general page layout that I know I want to achieve. And then from here, I look at it in more of a responsive landscape. So small screen and large screens. And you can notice that the priority shifts. And the priority could be shifting here in the case of maybe it's contextual factors as a whole. And you want to set priorities to users that you have information on. Let's just say it's a retail site. And maybe initially zone 1 is about a sale, but zone 2 and 3 is like men's clothes, women's clothes. But I've already identified me as a male buyer, and the promotion right now is not as important as an active user on here. So I'm going to push 2 and 3 up, and instead of 3 being women's clothes, I'm going to make it maybe some other feature about clothes or another piece of the website that's related to me as a male buyer going to a retail site. So this is more of just a setting prioritization of content in the different zones that you have and how they're going to shift from small screens to large screens. And it's just like that. It's just little zones that you put on a whiteboard and kind of plan out the strategy for the content. And then I break out each individual zone into their own components. So this module lives as its own piece, and it's, you know, it has this maybe background right here. It has this container. It has a call to action. It has a block copy, whatever. And then I would have another document that's relating to what each of these are, which would include its requirements of this block of copy can only be a maximum of 200 characters or something like that. So you live you look at them holistically, but then you break them down individually, and you're focusing on each component. And then like even like the call to action, you could break down into its own module. But that's how I get into these stories about every piece of the interface. And to me, wireframing should be done really quick and rapid. So here's an example of one of the projects I've been working on. This is a store locator. So this is the world right here. This is a map. And you know, like the Google stuff, there's the Google logo down there. And then this is a search. And here's a listing of all of them and some filtering. But what I was able to do is work with my visual designer, and he and I were both the UX people on this project, so we just kind of needed to like whiteboard it out. And over here was actually the strategy first of like the content blocking, and then here was like more of like how we're going to build it out. And we would have stories about like, all right, so here's this, and then little notes at the top. It's like, that means yes, if they opt in for geolocation, then you get the current location. If not, then you get city, state, zip inside of the placeholder in this input. So then we could talk to the application architect and be like, hey, can we actually do this inside the infrastructure that we have? And then from there, we would dissect this and build out the individual components of it. So said this a bunch of times, architecting modular solutions. Who remembers the Ben Callahan quote? That is right. Thanks, James Patrick. All right, and I said this earlier, but letting experts lead their craft, plan, collaborate, communicate, and end of day, listen to your users and making sure that you're crafting things that are really aligned to what the users are looking for, as well as the content strategy that you have out there. I'm sorry. This is the only annoying part of Keynote, is to go back. Did you want me to go back one more?
No, that's fine.
And so one thing that I didn't say this earlier, we are recording this. I don't know if we'll record the other ones. I'm just going to try this, and it's intended for you guys to have a playback of the conversation that we had today. And I can definitely send you my deck, so... But it only will run on Windows 8.1. So I just said this. Understanding your users is the most important part. And it's funny that I keep talking about this because we're supposed to be talking about CSS and HTML, but this is what's really important. It's the content strategy. It's planning for it. So now we hit on, here we actually are, CSS HTML syntax. So I'm going to break away from my actual guy here. And I'm going to open up a new browser window. And as I'm in here, let me know if you have any issues on seeing my screen. One second. I'm going to have to change my displays here. Cool. And then do something really quick here. And the hard thing with teaching any class with development as a whole is I want to kind of stay away from conversations about IDEs and text editors. So IDEs are software programs that are full suite and they help you in the development process. They're pretty robust. They're primarily used more for backend or compiled languages as a whole. Visual Studio is a really great one for .NET. Eclipse is fantastic for many reasons out there, but it's primarily used for Java. And there's all the Ruby Mine ones. I can't think of what is that company that makes what are some of the other ones from that?
WebStorm.
Yeah, WebStorm is a big one too. But I primarily use Sublime Text, and people debate about that. There's also Atom, and that's out there. AOTOM, not.
Dreamweaver.
Oh, yeah, there's Dreamweaver, too, but, it's at this point, it's personal preference. A lot of front-end devs and even, you know, integrated side have moved to Sublime Text, and some people have moved away from it. WebStorm's gotten really popular. I personally just use Sublime, which is just a text editor that has a bunch of plugins, and I can, if you guys are interested, we can talk about that. But it's really personal preference. Sublime, there's an unlimited free trial. You just get a disrupt as you're working on it. But I would highly recommend just shelling out the $60 for it, because those guys do a really, really great job to create a really fantastic program. But we're going to be using CodePen. and it's just for ease. So CodePen is just, you can do live editing and also developing inside of it. So just to give you an example, if I write hi here, you'll see it go right here. Can you guys see that? Fine. CodePen is just a website, so you go to codepen.io. I'm sorry? Oh, it's right here on the board. No, sorry, I didn't say that earlier. So, for purposes of this, what we're going to talk about is inheritance from the browser or the user agent as a whole. And I'm using Chrome. I prefer using Chrome. I know a lot of people go back and forth on it. I feel like less and less people are using Firefox to do development, where back in the day, it was one of the first ones that had live editing tools through Firebug. Chrome web developer tools are really fantastic, and I'm going to be showing you guys that. My personal preference and recommendation would be to use Chrome or Safari, but Chrome's, you know, stable, and it's awesome. And CodePen, it has some Zen coding in there, so if I type like div and I hit tab, it'll finish it for me. It also has, if I write lorem in here and I put like 20 and I hit tab, it'll put 20 words inside there and I'll see it update. It's pretty nice. I'm using Sass inside here, and Sass is a pre-compiler for CSS. If time permits, we'll talk about it, but for purposes of this class, we're going to be talking about writing CSS strictly. And if there's something that we don't get to in this class, again, I want to be your resource for helping you guys learn and continue to grow. So looking at just basic HTML, a web page as a whole, and CodePen already puts this out there, you have HTML. Inside the HTML, we have a head, and then we have body. These are the main components of it. The funny thing is about HTML that people don't realize is you don't even need to require. These are not required because the browser already can interpret it on modern browsers. But I would not recommend doing that. The reason why that is in some of the MVC frameworks, so like your Angular that's out there, they have what are called directives that are partial files, but they can also be run on their own. So you could take them out. So they're like individual applications that are inside your global application. So a module that has its own piece of code that's related to the project. And they can actually run on their own, but then when you put them inside the project, they kind of work well together. And because of that, you're able to break them out without an HTML tag inside of it. And then you'd also want to declare the doc type, but this is actually going to break CodePen. But this is where inside your link, I mean your header, you would add a link. Oops. Let me expand this out. And header is where I put link inside here. This is also where I put my title tag. Oops, not till. So title page. And I can also put some other meta descriptions inside there. So I can put like meta and then put description for, you know, page descriptions. But these are kind of like the core ones that you would want to put inside your project. And then all JavaScript should go at the bottom of the page. So it looks like this. And then I would put source is equal to wherever my, just pick a spot and just call it main.js. And I'll talk about what these are. And then I'll just put styles.css, I mean style, I'll call it main.css. So this is what like a basic HTML page looks like. And you can just create a file on your desktop with an extension.html and it'll run in the browser. That's all it takes. Like all you need is any text editor. You can use TextMate, and that's another one developers still use. You can use Notepad. You can use Notepad Plus on Windows. It doesn't matter as long as it's a text editor. You can even use Word. Would not recommend it, but you could do that if you really wanted to, just for fun. But all you really need is the HTML tag, this head tag, and the body tag. So body is where the main content of your website actually lives. And it's where it's rendering. So these are the main three components that you have. Title is when you go to the browser and you look at this, a pen by Kevin Mack, that's the title tag. The other pieces inside here, which SEO will be another class that we do, are more on that and also compatibility things that are for the browser. And then link. So link is a reference to how I call a CSS file. So I have my HTML document, I have my CSS file, and the CSS file is related to the code that I'm writing on this page. So the code in HTML, DOM is referred to as the structure of your code. So it is based off of XML, which is just a hierarchy language. It's also text-based. And what you would refer to it as is HTML is a node. So it's a component. It's a tag. So it's an HTML tag, but it's also a node in DOM. Inside of HTML, head is listed inside there. So it keeps this hierarchy of open and closed tags. So I have the open tag of HTML and a closed tag of HTML. What lives inside of HTML? Head lives in it. Body lives into it. These are children of my parent root, which is HTML. And that's what I refer to as DOM, is the breakdown of the parent-child hierarchy. So an HTML page has an HTML tag with the two children of head and body. Inside head, we have this title tag. So I say tag element. That's just not me. It's actually the specs of the different elements are called tags. Different elements are called, I should say, components. Some HTML components are elements. Some HTML components are tags. It's really confusing, and it doesn't really matter. But if you call it an element, people will know what you mean. If you call it a tag, whether you call it an element or a tag, people will know what you mean. And then link right here is a tag, and it has two different attributes inside of them. So these are attributes. So an element of HTML has, every single element has different attributes that can be applied to them. So the link has these two primary ones. There's some additional attributes, and I can show you where to look that up. But for you to render CSS on a page and relate it to your actual DOM structure, which is the HTML that you're writing, you need to do rel is equal to style sheet, href is equal to the location of where your CSS is. This path needs to be relative to where the HTML is. So in the case of where I have styles.main, my file or directory structure, so a directory is just like a folder structure. So inside here, I have my project name. Inside here, I have my, I'll call it index.html, which that's usually the default name that you put. So like in a URL, you have nicetransition.com. It would load index.html by default. But this could also be called foo.html. So if I went to nicetransition.com/foo.html, it would then render my DOM and my HTML from foo. And this is like super intro, but do you guys, so far are you following me with that as a whole? So it's just the directory structure. But then from here we have what I refer to as styles. And this is, and I'll kind of do this. So this is a folder. This is a folder. So index and foo, they're at the same level as index. So styles are at the same level as index as well as foo. So again, if this was nicetransition.com, to get to foo, I would have to put foo.html. Cool. And then styles, I have my main.css. Right. So the reference here, styles to main, is relative from this file to where this is. So my href is looking for the relative path to get here, which in the case of this, this is what the directory structure would look like. And when you work with server-side languages, you primarily, and I would not recommend building out individual pages as .html. Usually you're using server-side language to render the content using a database, where we get into this stuff. But for this class, we're focusing really on static HTML pages. And by static, I mean they're not dynamic. They're not pulling in content from the database. So far, Is this good? Making sense? And then I have my body. It's recommended to put your scripts at the end of the page, and this is related to performance. CSS you want inside your head. By head, these actually render before the page renders. So before anything happens on the page, it's making calls and downloading this guy. So if I have a JavaScript file and I have put it inside here, it's going to download that file, but that's not necessarily required for me to load the page. There's certain times where you do put stuff in your script, but that's getting down kind of a wild path right there. But as a whole, it's really just your CSS and some like the headers and how the page is going to render. So it's defining the page as a whole for the browsers. And then body is where all my HTML lives. So I'll put an H1 in here, and I'll put hello world. And then scripts are at the end. So the DOM is actually read from top to bottom. And the assets that you're including in here are going to be loaded last. So putting your JavaScript at the end, it's going to be loaded last. And also any references that I have in my JavaScript to my HTML, the HTML is already loaded inside the browser. So I can make references and enhance or manipulate the actual DOM structure as well as content to my containers here. Meaning that if the JavaScript was being declared ahead of it, the JavaScript's already loading and it's looking for DOM elements that do not exist yet in the page. By having it afterwards, if I was trying to target this guy, and maybe once the page rendered and loaded inside the browser, I wanted to change hello world to say, hello Adam. I could do that. But if this is ahead of this, it gets out of scope of how the page actually renders as a whole. So that's why it's recommended to put it at the end. This recommendation has probably been around for 4 years, but majority of sites are still not doing this. And there's different ways of doing loading.
So you basically put
Yeah. Exactly. So that's like a really introduction, like as quick as I can be talking about like performance in JavaScript. So then inside here, yeah, sorry.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the beginning of that.
Oh, yes. So that's the other thing. Some, especially if you're using JavaScript libraries, they've gotten dramatically smaller because, as I said, like the past couple of years, like front end's kind of more stabilized. But there's still cases where you see a JavaScript file that's like 300 kilobytes, which that doesn't seem like much, but it's enough to have a hiccup on a page. And you want your page to render as quickly as possible, especially when building an interface. And CSS has very slow hiccups, unless you're writing your code horribly wrong. But having anything inside your head, it's going to be downloaded before the page actually renders. So that's where you see those like little flickers. And even if it's like 5 milliseconds, that's enough for someone to realize that something seems like it's going wrong. And that's the funny thing. Like in the development world, like you have conversations about like, how can I get this quicker? And you're talking about like fractions of milliseconds to actually make something render. So looking at this, it's an H1. There's H1 through H6. Those are reserved for tags on the page. The old recommendation was that you had one H1 per page, and they're supposed to be the page title, like why I'm here. H2s kind of break down into different categories. A lot of people use H1 for the branding of the site. So in my case, my website, which if you go to my website, it's just a black page and says Pirate's Life. I just don't have time for my website. And so in the case if I had a true website and I wanted to brand Nice Transition, let's just say it's Kevin Mack. My H1 would say Kevin Mack. And then maybe the H2 would be blog, if I had a blog. And then categories inside there, if there was an H3, it would be a blog title and so forth. So they're priority based off of the content on the page, but they're reserved for special things. P stands for paragraph, and that's where you put your content and your tags in it. And it's really important to actually relate the content that you're writing and the elements that you're using. The elements that you're using on the page should be related to the content. So if I have a block of text like this, it should be using the paragraph tag. even though it would still render under something like a div, and visually it looks the same, but it's not correct. So these guys, this is a div, and this is just one of the main structures. It's kind of a loose element as a whole that you can use and apply, and it's you'll see the word div a lot when you're writing code. There's a handful of them, and definitely we don't have time to dive into most of them. But understanding this and having a p tag inside here and my content goes inside there, that is best practices. And it's also related to like SEO, search engine optimization, or your SEM strategy. So you use the elements based off the content that you have. So far, have I said anything that is wildly crazy or feeling good so far? All right, so I'm going to clear this out. Because as I said, CodePen already puts this in here for me. So let's visit just the H1 and write hello world. Whoa. And put a paragraph tag back in here, and I'm going to do a little 20. All right, so we'll see this guy. Now, CSS, if I look at this and getting into inspector, I can go inspect element in Chrome. And I get brought up this really crazy tool here, and it's incredibly useful. This is where, when you're developing interfaces, you're living your life. And just to kind of show you it outside of CodePen, because it is loading first the CodePen HTML and then the different sections inside there. You know, this is actually the canvas of the Chrome of CodePen. And inside this iframe is the actual content that we want to be looking at. But it's broken down here. So when I'm inspecting this, traditionally our website would just be starting here and it wouldn't have all that fluff up there. I'll show you. Why can't I think of a single example? We'll just go to my website because it's so good. There we go. As I said, pirate's life. So I inspect this, and this is more like what a traditional page would look like. It just has the HTML tag and stuff inside of it, which if I had content in there, it would live inside the body. So here we go. I don't know why I said that. But getting into this tool, so over here on the left is all the DOM that's being rendered on the page. On the right, I have all these other helpers. For this course, what we're going to stick on is the elements, which is the DOM, and really the styles, which can come up on the side, and looking at styles in computed. There's other really nice things, especially like console, when you're developing JavaScript or even using server-side languages to ping the front end. But it's a super powerful tool, and I'll kind of get into this in a moment. So getting into the syntax of CSS as a whole, it starts with your selector. So I'm just going to say body, and then it has curly brackets. Formatting, as you're writing code, you should be trying to write your code based off the styles of the other developers. So as you're writing code, kind of come up and talk about like the best way that people feel comfortable. But the idea is when you're developing multiple developers on a project, should look like there was only one developer writing the code. So just consistency as a whole. So here's body. That's my selector. And then it has curly brackets right here. Inside there, I add a property. So the property I'm going to use is background color. And I'm going to say red. So this is my key. And then this is my value. So this is a block of CSS code right now. So we have the selector, curly brackets, and a property and a value. And they end with a semicolon.
Are those universal properties? Just used throughout, like, that's just basic CSS language.
Yeah, it's CSS language as a whole. So then if I wanted to define my color, I put this. So body is a type selector, meaning that it is looking at a tag. I could also, instead of being on body, so body's the outermost, but actually it's not. HTML is the outermost. So I could also apply this to the HTML, and it's going to be interpreted down. And this is also a really great example of inheritance, and I'll show you what that means in a second. HTML is also a tag. I can also do root, which is the highest level of a project. And Root has become very popular, as I mentioned, with MVC frameworks. So in the case of this code right here, Root is equal to HTML. It is a selector at the highest, it's the parent container of all the DOM inside of it, is Root. But in the case of this, HTML, most people, I would not recommend doing HTML. If you're putting body styles, bless you, or is that a cough? Yeah, all right, cool. Body is where you usually put like background color and also the set of everything. But this is a type selector. Same thing as div. Oops. Dickfoot. So I don't have a div. I'm going to put one in here. And then I'm going to move this paragraph. Actually, I'm going to just put a new one in here. I'll say lorem 3. So now everything inside this div is now red, but the rest of the page isn't. And that's because it's targeting div, which is this element, and it's applying this color. So far, anything in div has a background color red and has a background color, color of white and a background color red. If I had two of them on a page that's separated with these paragraphs, they both get applied to it. So div is, again, a type selector, and it's going here. Type selectors are really reserved only primarily for resets or stabilizing across browsers. So the fact that I put div here, you should never really do that. Really, the only type selector that you should be styling is body. Type selectors are, again, really just reserved to resets and normalizing. So different browsers have different ways that they render their user agents on specific elements. And paragraph is going to be an example that I show you by that. So what we want to do is, if I only want to target this bottom div, I'm going to call and create a class that's called foo. So foo is my class here. So what classes are, they start with a dot and then whatever that name is. So dot foo. So this is a primary class selector. So this div has an attribute, and the attribute is class. And it is equal to foo. Foo has background color red and text color white. And is only being applied here. If I wanted to apply it maybe to this paragraph, I can apply class to anywhere. It can be applied to multiple places on the page. And it works on all sorts of things. Hello. Cool. So that's a class selector. Now, there's IDs. I'm just going to call it foo. This will maybe confuse some of you. And I'm just going to add a border, 10 pixel solid blue. IDs are reserved for one item on a page. And they're not supposed to be reused. Where selectors, you have multiple on a page. I can use foo as many times as I want. And that's perfectly fine. That's actually recommended. IDs are one thing only. For some reason, let's just say this div was the only div in the world in this whole project that was going to be border 10 pixel solid. I would have at ID, attribute ID is equal to foo. And then how I look at my CSS stylings for IDs is I put hash foo or pound foo, whatever you want to say, and it's getting applied there. Now, the browser will let me actually put it on here, but in reality, if you run this through anything, this is not correct code. Even though it allows me, this is something that you should never do. People make the debate that you should never style on IDs, similar to like how you shouldn't be styling on type selectors. And instead of doing that, you could just create another class. So I steer away from IDs as a whole. Usually on my project, the only ID that I may use is maybe like a main, which is like my main body content. But IDs are really reserved for more of the JavaScript side and unique individual in zones and components. A lot of the server-side languages will compile IDs for you, and they may even change. But you can only have one ID per element, too. Other thing is, you can see that I have foo, that is a class, and foo, that is an ID selector. Now, the difference is, this is an ID, and this is a class, and it doesn't matter that they're the same. You can have an ID and a class that have the same name, but they don't interpret, they do not have any conflicts at all. So instead of foo, I'm going to call it bar. And then I'm going to change this to class and call it bar. So now we have this guy, which is bar, and he's applying the bar selector, which is a class, and I'm using the class attribute here and using bar, which renders in the page to have a 10 pixel blue border. And then we have foo, which is a class selector, and it's using class attribute where the value is equal to foo, and we have these red. Now what I can also do is, with classes, I can add multiple classes on the class attribute. So let's say this paragraph, which is right here, I want it to have a blue background. I can now do this. So now you can combine the two classes and get an output. So when we look at this in the code, and use inspect, I go to foo bar, and we see that it has inherited the styles from bar as well as the styles from foo, where this paragraph tag only gets foo. Everyone get on that? Because that is one of the core concepts of CSS, and also the difference between IDs and classes. And this we're going to move on from here really kind of quickly over the next, it's definitely in our next course. It's all going to be just in the code, and understanding this is the most important part. There's a handful of other attributes, selectors, and we'll cover them, but I'm just going to start with classes right now. And the last piece that we're really going to end up on, as I said, is inheritance as a whole. So let's look at this page. I'm going to save this so I can open it. Yeah. Yeah. And that's a really great question. So divs, can I come back to that? Because I think I'll be able to explain a little bit better by going through what inheritance is. Because every single element that exists has inherited properties from the browser that are by definition for them. For example, if I say div element and I say w3c org, I can actually go out here and read that spec. Oh. And I can see its global attributes. So these are all the attributes that can be applied to this div. And there's a lot of awesome ones. You can also create custom attributes if you want and actually use them as selectors. But these are all the possible attributes that are out there. And then, and again, you can do this with any element. Where was I going to go with this? So if I look at inside here, and I look at a span, right? This is getting into inheritance from the browser, so using the user agent. This is one of the number one things that even front-end developers, I would say, don't get. Because every time I always talk about inheritance for the browser, people are like, oh, I never knew that happened. So let's look at span here. And using Chrome developer tools, I can see, first off, that it says inherited from HTML. And it says font family sans serif. And then, so that's the only one that's being inherited. If I go to div, I see that it has the font family inherited. Hold on, I need, with my smaller screen here, missing something. Let me zoom out. So, make this bigger again. So I look at this div, and the cool thing is, as I highlight here, it highlights it on the page, which piece I'm looking at, and I can also right-click and say inspect, and it'll highlight it here for me. So foobar is this red with the blue. I can see, that, again, those classes that I've applied from my CSS, the blue border, the background color red, and the white. But then I see this user agent display block, which a display block, and we'll definitely be talking more about the display property, CSS property, which in the case of this is display, and the value being block. I don't need to define display inside my code because the user agent's already doing it for me. So in the case of this guy, I wanted it to span the full width from left to right of the browser, so the full viewport of the visible screen. Divs as a whole do that naturally, and that's what a display block value does in CSS. So this div, by default, has user agent display block, but then I've also inherited from my HTML the sans serif font, as well as some other little goodies. If I look at paragraph, and this is inheritance from CSS. So it's both from the properties, from previously defined selectors in your CSS, as well as the actual element that you're using and developing with. Paragraph is a great example of this. We see that by default it has a display block. It also has this margin before, after, start, and end. When it comes to global units in CSS, there's two main that you use. It's margin and padding. Margin refers to what happens outside that DOM element, and padding is what happens inside of it. So padding's inside, margin's outside. Yep. So let me remove any CSS. And removing your CSS and looking at this also is related to creating a content strategy. So it's referred to as linear design. So linear design means you're stacking your content and using the elements that make sense. So when I remove my CSS, this page renders the way that I still want it to see. So the actual output in my DOM is related to the content types that I have and the priority for the page. So if I look at this guy, again, no CSS applied, you can still see some formatting, and the browser has these margins already built into it. That's why it's being spaced here. The div right here has no margins around it. And the cool thing about development tools, do you see this orange around it? It's showing the computed margin around it. And I can also go to computed, and it will tell me what the margins are, which is really awesome. And if there's a border or anything inside there, and it also tells me the size of it. But this div has no margin, border, padding. So different elements have these in the base. And this is what I was referring to as setting a reset on type elements. Now, I am not a fan of doing resets on elements. But I've seen this. This is a pretty common one. Actually, the only one that I really do it on, and this is literally the most common one. We look at body, which they have normalized inside here, which I can turn it off. By default, we'll just use this as my scratch page here. So I'm just going to create a blank page just using inspect. Oops. Right. Right after I did it. Let's just delete this. So I have this blank page, right? And I see other cool thing like Chrome developer tools. I can also just kind of like hack something together. So if I just put a block of code like this, are you guys familiar with this? You can see that there's like this built-in padding around this, even though I haven't defined that. And I want this guy to be flush in the corner. That's because the body tag actually has a default margin of 8 pixels. So what I can do is say body margin 0. Literally, this is the most common one. That's the base reset. So now I've removed that user agent. So by default, body had a margin 8, and I want it to have 0 because I want to control that with my interface. Luckily, they already built that in for us here. So that's usually the first one that I do is I put a body in there and margin reset. So if I wanted to remove the padding and kind of stabilize my paragraphs to look like a div, I could do a reset here and say margin top 0. Oops. Space. And margin bottom 0. And now all these guys are going to be stacked next to each other. So I've reset the paragraph to remove it. Same thing with my H1. It has this M setting, which M's are just based off the base font that you've defined here. Maybe I don't want that, so I could also say H1s. This is the other cool thing with properties. You can write them this way. You can say selector, whether it's a type, ID, or a class. I separate them with commas and put a space. And now paragraphs and H1s also get these properties. So if I look at the code here, inspect H1, margin top, 0. You can see that the P's kind of grayed out here, if you can see that. And the H1's black, meaning this is an H1. And I go to my paragraph tag now, I highlight it, inspect it. It also has that. It's cool.
Yeah, I have a question.
Yeah, what's up? Can I see it?
Okay, no, that's a good point. So how Chrome renders, it's a little bit weird. So me doing this margin top and bottom, I'm doing it on the base. But if you actually look at Inspector, it says WebKit. So WebKit is just one of the engines. So Chrome's actually forks the nightly version of WebKit, which is just like one of the processes, engines that build a browser. I'm trying to think, what browsers are just WebKit these days?
Safari
forks it. They have their own proprietary properties. Anyways, it doesn't matter, but inside here, you'll see that it says WebKit margin, top, bottom. But if I'm styling for legacy browsers like your Internet Explorer, they still have them, but they have them defined as margin top, margin bottom. Weird. It's so weird because I could literally just copy this and do WebKit margin before a 0, and I get the same look and feel. But then if I open it up in IE8, I would have that space still there. So margin top, margin bottom are a harder reset. This is a kind of a quirky one. It's if you see before, it means top. If you see after, it means bottom. If you see start, it means left. So it goes left, before, end. So it's hard to do that because in reality it's top. I'm trying to think of this backwards too. And that's what's making this really. So for me, it's top, right, bottom, left. And that's how it's actually looked at. So top, right, bottom, left. But in WebKit, it's before, after, start, end.
So basically, there's
yeah, yeah. So that's what margin top bottom does. So I've just applied one other thing on the body tag. It says font family Arial, and I'm also going to do font size 16, and I'm also going to do say color red just because it's noticeable. So now if I look at these guys, I did not apply color, and I did not apply a font family to any of these guys, but it's inherited it, and that's because body in the DOM is above the actual selectors, I mean the actual DOM elements I have. So by applying it to body, everything inside body gets it. If I did this on div again, anything in div would get this guy. And let's think of a good font to put in here. Font family times. So at the body level, all my fonts are being defined as Times New Roman or Times. And then anything inside a div has an Arial font. So if I look at this in inspect, and again, I didn't apply it to my H1, which is my H1, right? And if I look at how this is being computed, I have
you know what, I'm gonna turn off that really quickly. Oh man. There we go. All right, so now if I go back here, let me put back in that margin, zero. So this guy will go back up to the corner. There we go. So I've reset that body. So the type selector of body has a margin 0, which by the default user agent has 8. This H1 has been reset right here on the type selector of H1, which is also shared between P. So it has two properties, which is margin top, margin bottom, resetting the WebKit margin start, margin, I mean margin before and margin after. And then the other thing that we'll notice is the user agent for H1 has all these properties that are inherited here, like the font size. But you remember that I set the body to have a font size of, oops, I thought I did, have a font size of 16. Small real estate. All right, so I set this as a base font at 16 pixels, but this guy is actually being computed right here. And this is another really helpful tool, is going to the computer. You actually see all the properties, whether they're not defined, and what they're actually coming out as. So this is every single thing that's inherited in this property. And they're in alphabetical order. So I'm looking for font size. It says 32 pixels. Even though I defined the body as 16, that's because the H1 has a user agent where the font size is equal to 2m. So in m's, it's just 2 times the 16 to render it out. And m's are actually the vertical height, so the from the top to the bottom, descender and extender. So it's rendering as 32 pixels. I could reset that and set it to something else if I wanted to, but that's traditionally a good size for it. And then these guys are being rendered as computed. Let's go back here. Font size 16. They're inheriting the font family Arial. So again, paragraph, user agent. User agent means from the browser. And then I see inheritance from my actual CSS and how it's being rendered. So my div here has a font family of Arial. So if I look at this, the div is the parent to paragraph, or the p tag, where my content is. So this guy has the style of Arial and the color red. Because it's inside here, it's inheriting the styles. So I highlight p, and I look at where, why is my color red? I don't want it to be red. It's because it was around this div type selector, and it's getting inherited from here. Now I look at my H1, it is inheriting the times because that was defined on body. And you'll see the slash. The slash means it's being overwritten. And this is a really important thing to take away. You don't want to see a lot of slashes like in your code at all. The only times you want to see slashes is when you're dealing with user agent as well as inheritance. It's very hard to say like your whole project will not have a slash. I try to achieve that in everything that I write, but sometimes I have to go crazy to make that happen. I'm just like, ah, forget it. I'll have one like little slash. So a slash means that you're overwriting. So back to what I was saying, you should look at CSS as extending and not overwriting values. Right here, this is okay though, because it's being inherited. So you're allowed to override inheritance as well as the user agent. But if I'm overriding a selector with another selector, that's where it gets complex. And I'll show you an example.
What do you mean by user agent?
So user agent is the actual browser here. So Chrome, my browser, has the definitions that they've gotten from the actual specs from WebKit as well as W3C org and the other organizations, where each element has definite has defined definition of what they are in their use cases. Yeah. So I'm inheriting here. Here's the user agent for this guy. And then, here's this guy. So what I just said was about the conflicts as a whole. So here's div and here's red. Again, you should not be styling on a type selector at all. But I am right now for really this purpose. So let's visit bar. So div, my type here, has a class of bar. Right now, divs have the color red. And let's make bar have the color blue. What do you guys think is going to happen when I do this? So I'm selecting, I'm defining this guy by two different selectors, but I have the same property, which is color. So in the case of div, I have the color being red. And in the case of it being dot bar, I have it defined as blue. Partially right. Well, that's you both are right on that for certain aspects of it, and I'll show you what I mean. It's going to be blue because of specificity. So specificity is over declaring and also the sort order of it. So a div is a global, it's higher structure, but adding a class is more specific and it's more style to it. And if I did something like this, say this was like thousands and thousands of lines of code, and then I was like, I want bar to be yellow. In the case of sort order, it will now be yellow. Now, let's look at what that looks like in Inspector. It's horrible code. And here's why. I select bar. Let's start back with inherited from body, 16 pixels. We're scratching this out, but that's okay because it's inheritance and you're allowed to override inheritance. It has a user agent of block. Really awesome. That's fine. Now we see this is from my styles, and this is where it gets into bad code. These are the slashes that you want to avoid. These get into performance issues as well as maintainability issues as well as into those three assumptions that I was talking about earlier. Once you see this and it was not intentional, something has gone horribly wrong. Not horribly, it's just gone wrong. I'm not going to be too dramatic here. So we have font family Arial, which again was the override of the inheritance of the body. This is cool. There's no slash there, but color red is being slashed out. And then we see bar, which is blue. But nowhere in this page am I seeing red, am I seeing blue, or the only one I'm seeing is yellow. And it's because, and this is really bad, when you see it stacked up the same selector, the same selector, the same property, and I'm just overriding it. So what you actually need to do is take a step back and look at your code and be like, let's add a new selector, or are we changing where it was blue everywhere to now changing it to yellow everywhere? You have to make that decision. And this happens in majority of projects that I do see. So this is what I mean by just inheritance and the conflicts of them. So far, how do you guys feel about inheritance as a whole and user agents?
I just want to make sure I understand. So we're trying to avoid overriding values unless it's an inheritance. That's a different story. It was kind of interesting.
Yep.
But it sounds like to me that what really happened was there was two selectors with the same name, two classes with the same name.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but here we're only working with a few lines of code, and projects are a lot bigger than this. So in reality, like, you may not realize that you're doing it, you know, like that just update that type of scenario, and I go in there and I update it, and then I realize this when I inspect it. And a lot of times when you're making those quick updates, you're not going to be diving down and looking at every inheritance. That's in the beginning stages, or if you're creating like reusable components, as we'll talk about later.
So when you've got the two classes, the two bars.
Yeah.
Can you show that in non-inspect element? Did you see that in your CSS section? Where is that?
So right here, yellow
yeah.
is below blue. Now, if I move blue afterwards, this is the cascading effect of CSS. It will now be blue. So CSS reads from top to bottom. And one of the topics, especially as we talk about it CSS, you look at it at a wide spectrum, so trying to reach as many elements as possible. So me defining a font family on body is I'm trying to say everywhere on our site, we want it to be Times, because that's our brand font. And then in certain cases, for legibility, I want it to be Arial. And maybe it's on all my paragraph tags, so far reaching. And then specific styling gets added on later on. But it's the sort order that defines whether this is blue or yellow.
So your inspect element is kind of like a cheat sheet
yep.
to your code, and it's telling you what you're doing.
Yep. But now I'm going to show you one last thing, and this is going to be the last piece that we end on today, which is just back to specificity. And specificity is, again, it's this. So it's multiple selectors looking at it. So in the case of bar, if I said div.bar and made it yellow, yellow now wins, even though it's not at the bottom. Because I've made this very specific to this individual piece. Now if I copied this, and let's put it on another element. Let's just put it on this paragraph tag, right? It's red, or it's blue. The reason is, this is saying, apply bar to this div. So a div that has dot bar gets yellow. And that's more specific than the div that was red. So if I just remove this, it gets blue because it's inheriting here. If this didn't exist, it would be red. Because I have a div that has the style red, I have a bar that's blue that comes at the end, but then this has both the div and the bar, and it's becoming more specific. Again, this is something that does come up, and there are good use cases for it, but in reality, this breaks away from modularity and also reuse. And really, the reason why I had to add this div was because I knew I wanted it to be yellow, and I didn't know the effects of what it would be on my blue. And then there's even more dive downs of specificity, which would be P. This is making sure that that paragraph is yellow. So this is saying a paragraph that's inside of a div that has a class of bar is yellow. Right? Now, one last thing is, let's make another example here, and let's just wrap this with a div. So we have yellow. I want to make that actually green. But I want the top one to be green, or I want the bottom one to be green and the top one to stay yellow. I say something like this, all right, that doesn't work. But what I can do is something like this. Come on. All right, did I screw this up? That should have worked. Let's just do another hack. There we go. There, that, now it's yellow. But now what I'm saying is if it's bar, which is a double selector, which is, it's a CSS hack. It's similar to doing an important, which importance should be used incredibly rare. So important is like a sledgehammer. It means no matter where it is on the page, it's always gonna win. It can be the first thing, it can be the last thing. It's always gonna win. Unless it's competing with another important, which then gets into the specificity wars. Yes. Yeah. So a lot of things I'm showing you right now are not best practices. It's to illustrate what specificity and inheritance are. So right here, this is saying a direct, and let me do an outline. So those guys have it. So what this is saying and why the other guy doesn't have it, let's forget about the yellow right now. So this bar versus this guy, why the first guy gets the red border is because in the DOM it goes div, not this, hold on, yeah, it goes, thought I had that. Okay, so why, so this guy does not get the red, right? So I put an X in front of it. Because it has bar, it has another wrapper of a div and then a paragraph. But what this guy is saying is dot div dot bar, the direct child of it is a paragraph. Only apply it there. By removing this, it's saying anywhere inside of div dot bar that there's a paragraph, you get an outline. This is specificity. It's defining it explicitly to say I only want a paragraph here. Yeah.
If we had two paragraph children of that div, first level children that would work above, it's not like first.
Yeah, so if I just threw another one inside there.
Yeah, yeah.
Yep. So I'm gonna end up really on this because we're really over now. But this is what I was meaning by specificity. It's this anchor that has a dot bar, that somewhere inside the DOM, there's a foo, so a parent that has a parent somewhere in there that is selected. So in the case of looking at that green here, we had the body that had a times, but then we had a definition of div that had Arial, and then we had actually foo that had the color, I think, red. And then if this was a P instead of an A, we defined it as green. So the specificity is the definition of going down. And you want to try to keep your selectors as short as possible. And that's really where I plan to kind of end today and where we would kind of continue this in the next class. So far, I know if you guys aren't familiar with this, this may be, is anyone, like, is this over someone's head at all? And please, again, like, be open, because I can come back and kind of prepare on here, and we're going to be hitting on this more, because this is the basis of CSS. This is where it goes wrong and why people don't understand it.
Like, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, say if you had a website and most of your text you wanted it to be yellow, mm-hmm. and then only certain paragraphs were green or something, mm-hmm. you would define in your CSS first, like,
It depends. So it's like, is it global? So if it's global, all your fonts yellow, and you put on your body tag. And then if it was just specific ones, we'd create a class and apply it to that paragraph or some kind of container class, so it would inherit it. So cool. So far, good use of your time.
Thank you.
Yeah, you guys learn anything today?
I've never known about that. I always thought CSS is the style of the paper.
Yeah.
You put your selector and you put your style into the bed. I didn't realize that you should have classes for that class.
Yeah. And you can also do inline CSS, but I would never really recommend that at all. So. Cool. Well, thank you guys. I know it's Saturday morning and it's a beautiful day. I appreciate your time and I look forward to seeing you guys next week. And if you have any questions, please don't hesitate. Reach out to me. Twitter, nice transition.